All right, guys. So welcome to all of you for the webinar. Let me just introduce myself quickly. My name is Dhvani, and for delivering today's webinar, I have my colleague with me, Mr. Bhanu. So we both will walk you through the very interesting terms in IoT, MQTT and CoAP. So few terms about logistics. You have to use chat window, so chat window will be the main tool for us for communication. Whatever queries, whatever doubts you have, you can just hit into the chat windows. We will have 15 minutes, last 15 minutes for question and answer. It will be total a 60-minute webinar session, in which last 15 minutes will be the Q&A session. Remaining 45 minutes will be the presentation in which we will talk about what are the protocols, what exactly MQTT, what are the technical terms that are involved in MQTT and CoAP as well. Okay. Moreover, let me just talk about Exelta first. My name is, I was introducing myself. My name is Dhvani, and I have been associated with Exelta Systems from long time related to IoT trainings and some development side of area as well. So if we talk about Exelta, it is the basically started by two IIT engineers. Both of them are passionate about the technology, and both of them have 21 plus years of experience. We are based out of Hyderabad, and the Economic Times rated us as the top 5 IoT companies. Moreover, Silicon India has also rated us in the top startup into the IoT in 2015 as well as in 2016. So it's the good thing for all of us. Along with that, we have trained more than 3,000 plus people across the globe. And we have worldwide IoT Connect ecosystem of more than 10,000 plus professionals. So that was the quick introduction about Exelta. This is the founder's profile. As you can see, both of them are B-Tech. Okay, let me just fix it. Give me a second. All right, so this is the founder's profile. Both of them are B.Tech graduated from IIT Roorkee. Both of them have worked in world's top IoT companies, like you can see TCS, ADP India and Tech Mahindra and all that. So both of them are passionate about learning the technology, about spreading the knowledge of technology and, you know, providing the IoT based solutions. These are the current offerings, like what we are into exactly. Basically, we are into the two parts. One is IoT production development. We do IoT solutions. We provide IoT solutions to the customer. And these are some of the products like Boom Barrier. We have billboard management systems, locker security systems, and many more. Along with that, we are into training side of part as well, wherein, you know, we give the IoT bootcamp, the basic IoT training. Along with that, we have the special MQTT and CoAP training as well. Apart from that, we have IoT Architect, that is the world's largest IoT platform training, which is ThingWorx. And along with that, we have a special training program for kids also, because it's very important for kids to learn the technology as well. So for that purpose, we have a franchisee training, term called Tiger Kids. Along with that, we do provide many of the corporate trainings and COE, like Center of Excellence college trainings as well. So as you can see, these are the training and product clients of Exelta Systems. We have many more clients, but the space was not enough for us to put all those here. So as you can see, many of the top companies are associated with us, like Intel, HCL, Tata, CA Technology and all. So many of the companies are associated. So this is the agenda. Like now we'll start the exact webinar. This is the session, this is the agenda, what we are supposed to cover in this 45 minutes is what is IoT, because it's very important to understand the term, right? Because that's what very important here. Second is we'll understand what do you mean by protocol, technology and standard. These are the three basic terms which we need to understand before learning or before getting into the any of the protocol. After that, we'll talk about what are the network protocol stack, and we'll talk about the MQTT, what are the structure, what are the features, why MQTT is used, where MQTT is used exactly into the market right now. We'll definitely talk about that as well. Along with that, we'll understand what are the constraint devices, what is the need of constraint devices, why CoAP came into existence, how CoAP is capable to connect constraint devices. And after that, we'll definitely talk about the booming protocols like MQTT, CoAP, and HTTP as well, because HTTP is a protocol which is nowadays used across the globe. So we will have a comparison look of all of three. So this is what the agenda. Now let's talk about IoT. Let's understand what is IoT and what is the need of it. So as you can see here, this is the device. Okay, so for example, I'll say it's just a wristwatch, and I am interested in making it as IoT enabled. Guys, a quick check, am I audible to all of you properly? Because I can see some messages are coming to me in private, so I just want to have a quick check. Okay. All right. So as you can see, this is a watch, a wristwatch, and I'm interested in making it as IoT enabled. So moreover, I could say I want to make this watch as a smart connected product. So whenever I say I want to make any device, now it could be anything. It's just a wristwatch. It could be anything. It could be a AC. It could be a television. It could be a fridge. It could be anything. So basically, okay, so basically what you are doing here is you are making any of the product as smart or any of the product as IoT enabled. Now whenever we talk about IoT, then every device will have a unique identity. Whenever any device, you want to make it IoT enabled, you want to make it as a connected product, it should definitely get some unique identity. Now in this scenario, the unique identity will be your IPv4 or IPv6 addresses. Right, once your device will get the unique identity, the second step is to make them smart. Now we generally say we human beings are smart, right? Why? Because we have deep sensors. We have got brain, we have touch senses, we have eyes, we have tongue to sense the taste. So that is the reason we human beings are smart. In the same way, whenever you want to make any product as smart, definitely you need to put some sensors into it. Now these sensors will make your product as smart. Once your sensors will fit into your product, definitely they'll start generating the data, right? And you cannot keep that data into the air. And for that purpose, definitely you will need some space to store that data. Okay, so once you put the sensors into your device, they'll generate some data. Now you want to push that data into your cloud. Now for that purpose, we have the device called gateway. So gateway is nothing but your aggregating device which uses the concepts of, you know, like microserver and some chip kind of programming. Now whenever you want to make communication between your sensor to cloud, it should be the path will be across the gateway. Now, whenever you want to make the connection or the communication between the sensor to gateway, you have to use the short-range communication protocol. You have to use the short-range communication protocol like ZigBee, Z-Wave, and BLE. And whenever you want to make the communication between your cloud to gateway, you have the protocol called MQTT, CoAP, and other application layer protocol. So our CoAP and MQTT suits for this kind of communication. So basically whenever you are trying to push your data from your gateway to cloud, these are the IoT protocols that are being used. Once your data is into the cloud, you are open to make any analytical reports, or you can generate any mining kind of results into that, and you can have the solution for your problem. So this is the end-to-end process of IoT, right? So IoT is nothing but your communication from your sensor to cloud. So this is how any product is becoming smart nowadays. So this is the general ecosystem for IoT. Okay. Now, if we go ahead, this is a generic diagram, I could say, wherein you can see this. These are the IoT endpoints, wherein you can see these are the sensors, and we are trying to connect it to the client. Right. So, for that purpose, we have some IoT infrastructure, like this will be the IoT routers, which will be basically acting as the gateways. So, your sensors are generating the data, pushing it into the gateway. Your gateway will have some internet infrastructure, or moreover, I can say the edge routers, which will be pushing your data into the cloud, that means to your data center. And once your data will come in, once when your data will be arrived into the cloud, you can make any of these operations. You can perform any analytics kind of stuff. You can, you know, manage your data, provision your data, sort it as per your need. Storage could be anything. You can store basically any type of data into it. And whatever device or whatever end user application will be generated, that will be available for all the client devices. So same process, same ecosystem, just a different scenario we have given here. Right. So basically, your IoT stuff is nothing but your data which is being generated from your sensor till the cloud communication. Now let's understand what do you mean by protocol, right? Because it is very important stuff. Whenever we use the term protocol, it has the big meaning. Okay, now let's understand. Protocol are nothing but just the set of rules for, you know, making two devices to communicate. Now, for example, let's say we are human beings, right? We are talking to each other with the help of one common language called English. So definitely there are certain set of rules or certain set of implies that we are following. For example, our frequency matching, our voice waves are matching. That's the reason you're properly able to hear me. I'm able to get the response from your side. We are following certain rules. That means, let's say you are one device, I am one device, and we both are talking to each other. So definitely we are following some rules. Let's say if you are, let's say if I use French language, you won't be able to understand that. So that means we are following certain set of rules. So these rules are nothing but the protocol. In the same way, if we compare with the devices, so two devices want to communicate with each other. In the same way, they also have to follow some kind of rules, certain rules, and those rules are nothing but your protocol. Right. And briefly, if we go ahead, there are basically three terms. One is protocol, technology, and standards. Now let's understand what is the idea behind all these three terms. So I think protocol are much more clear now. Protocol are nothing but just the rules that you have to follow. Technology is a technology or it's the term where in your protocol lies. For example, if I talk about Bluetooth, now there are few protocols that are there like your TCP and IP which follows the Bluetooth technology, right? So your protocol basically lies within the technology and your technology falls under some standard. Now, for example, if you talk about Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, this technology falls in a standard called IEEE 802.11. If you talk about ZigBee and NFC and GSM, this technology basically falls under a standard called 802.15. So when you talk about protocol, it's not only just a protocol. Basically, it uses some kind of communicating technology as well, which uses the standards as well. So it's a complete hierarchy. Right, so wherein you have to use a protocol, your technology, and your standards as well. So MQTT basically falls into the any of the technology. Basically, you can go for like Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and ZigBee as well. All the technology in which the TCP falls can use MQTT inside it. So that is the basic idea behind it. Okay, any technology which is using TCP can have MQTT because MQTT lies on top of TCP. So that is the idea behind it. Now if we talk about some IoT protocols, these are the few most widely used IoT protocol, like HTTP, definitely a buzzword because nowadays everyone is using HTTP. Again, MQTT, CoAP, So MQTT are basically used for long range communication protocols. CoAP are specifically used for constrained devices. Definitely the big terms to discuss about in upcoming few minutes. We'll definitely talk in much more detail about MQTT and CoAP. Along with that, we have the widely used protocols like XMPP and AMQP, which are specifically designed for message related communication part of area. Right, so XMPP basically uses XML as their core data format in order to communication, and AMQP falls inside the queuing mechanism wherein, you know, your messages will be divided and the first come first serve type of queuing mechanism will be provided inside the AMQP. So these are all the application layer protocols, specifically known as IoT protocols, because these protocols are most widely used in IoT related applications. Now, this is the complete network protocol stack. It's very important to understand any protocol stack. Like, before getting into the actual knowledge about the protocol, it's very important to understand all the layers where the different protocol lies. So this is the OSI model. Whatever protocol we gonna talk about are the application layer protocol, as you can see. So your HTTP, MQTT, CoAP, XMPP, all the protocol lies in the application layer. Now these are the basic layer, physical layer, data link layer, network layer. So each layer will be talking to the same layer at the other node, at the other end. So there, basically, if we talk about, let's say two nodes are talking to each other or two devices are talking to each other, so each and every layer of OSI model will talk to the same layer at the other point, at the different point. So that's the idea behind it. And whatever the protocol we're gonna talk about, will all of them are falling inside the application layer. Right, now this is the standardization of IoT protocol stack. Now if you can see, this is the web stack, like if you consider the general protocol web stack, and if you compare this web stack with your IoT protocol stack, so this is the position. As you can see, this is the application layer. Right, so in IoT related development, in IoT applications, most widely CoAP and MQTT are used. If you compare same with the HTTP and DHCP, if you consider this IoT stack with web stack, HTTP is the most widely used protocol. And I can see a few questions are coming. So a quick note, guys, keep hitting your questions. At the last 15 minutes, I'll try and answer maximum of your questions. So whatever doubts or whatever queries you have, please hit it into the chat window. At last 15 minutes, I will definitely try to cover up all the questions. Okay, so this is the basic position of these two protocols, like where do they fall in a complete IoT stack. So I just wanted to elaborate that. So this is their position, right? And let's start about the MQTT, like why MQTT is used and all the stuff related to MQTT, right? So for explaining MQTT kind of side of part, I have my colleague with me, as I've explained you. So now what I'll do, I'll just transfer the session to him, and he'll walk you through all the basic and features of IoT, features of MQTT and all. So over to Bhanu.
Hi guys, good evening. Just as a quick note, can you guys hear me? Just type yes if you can. Okay then, now we are going to start with the session. So first thing, as Dhwani has described you about all the protocols and what is IoT and all, so we'll start with MQTT. So first thing is, here you can see on my on the screen which I have shared you, there is a the PPT slide. You can see where we have different type of sectors like transportation, logistics, security and surveillance, industry, energy, medical, healthcare. Everything is connected to a cloud which is mentioned as MQTT broker. So each and everything, you can see the communication between each and everything. If you can see the medical and healthcare over here, So each and every sector is having a arrow crossing to both the directions. That means that it can send the data and it can receive the data. Even in the transportation and logistics, it can send the data and receive the data. So this is how the MQTT works. Kushal will once we are going through this PPT, you will get to know what is a broker and all. So this thing is just the start of this session where we will be showing this shows a complete picture of how MQTT is going to work. So everything what we have done. So the next thing will be why. So here we are using our. Here we are using MQTT, but we need to know why we are using MQTT. Why not any other protocol? So the main features of MQTT are here. So it's a lightweight protocol. So where it has very few overheads. So if you when we see the header files, it has only 2 bytes of header. So it's very lightweight, and it has publish and subscribe model. And it is a simple protocol where we in this technology world, so we need to make things simple. So it shouldn't be much complicated. So where it compared to the simplicity, MQTT is very simple, and it runs on TCP/IP, and it has sensors and nodes can communicate with each other using a message broker. So these are all the few features where we can specify that why we need to use MQTT, why not others. And what are the key features what we have here is it's open protocol. So it is invented by IBM and Eurotech. So it is invented by IBM and Eurotech at the start, and then it is transferred to Eclipse, and the MQTT code client code of C and Java has been donated to Eclipse PAHO and M2M project. So this is one of the feature as it is an open protocol. The next thing is it is very lean, so it has very minimum size of packets. Like if when we compare to the header size, it has only two bytes of header. So as a fixed header, it has only 2 bytes. So it is very minimal header size, and it is very lean. And when we compare to the footprint of the code with the client, it is with if we take it as a C, it can be minimal up to 30 KB, and if we go with the Java, it will be minimal up to 100 KB. So the footprint is also very less when compared to when we have a constraint application. Like if you have so many applications, like in IoT applications, where just imagine that we have a logistic applications where we have seen in the previous slide, in the start first slide. So in the logistic applications, I have 50 trucks or 100 trucks where I have to apply sensors and nodes for each and every truck, and I have to give the power supply to each and everyone and every node of it. So I have very minimal amount of power source, like smaller battery. So if my protocol what I am using, if it has a bigger header or bigger computational power, the power consumption also will be high, and it will take much more power, and it will reduce every time I need to go to the truck and I need to change the batteries or something like that. So how lean it is also very important. So next thing will be the reliability. So how do I know whether my messages what I am transmitting will be reliable, or they processing correctly or not? If it is a medical process, so I need to know the complete structure, so complete information about the patient, like every minute what's happening with him. So if there is any heart attack or something, so it is a critical case where the information is required, and accurate information, there should not be any packet loss. So that's where reliable thing comes in. So MQTT will be providing 3 quality of services. One is 0, 1 and 2. Depending on our application process, we can change this quality of services. The 0 represents at most once delivery. So here you can see the 0 represents at most once delivery. It will deliver at most once. And 1 represents assured delivery, but maybe a duplicate. So assured that you will be getting a delivery of the packet, but it may you'll be also getting a duplicate packet. And 2, where you have 2 once and only once delivery. So it will deliver only once. There won't be any duplicates. So the next pin, here we have last will of testament. So once if unexpected things happen and the node gets damaged, or something happens and it's disconnected without our knowledge, then there will be a last will testament that, okay, this node has been disconnected. So that message will be passed. And next one is simple. As I said, as we are going forward into technology, everything should be simple. So the simpler things what we make, MQTT is very simple. Like it is asynchronous delivery. It will be using push and it will be going into asynchronous delivery. And we have set of verbs where in the specifications where we have simple things like connect, publish, subscribe and disconnect, which are very simple verbs where we can be used in the specifications. And the specifications are very less when compared to other protocols. These are very less specifications where we can implement all of those. And it is ideal for lossy and constrained network. As I said, constrained network, it might be power constraint, it might be hardware constraint, it might be anything, whatever the constrained networks or lossy networks where we don't, where there is a probability of losing our packets. So that's place where this MQTT is most suitable. And it runs over TCP/IP, which provides order and lossless connections. So moving to the next slide, we are having the MQTT architecture. Now we will get to know what actually is. Here you can see in the picture, we have two things. One side we have the publishers and the other side we have the subscribers. So MQTT is based on the publish and subscribe architecture. So every device here in this will be connected to the server over TCP. So server is nothing but here we have the broker over here. So when compared to this MQTT, so here everything, so publisher will be publishing the topics to the MQTT broker, and the subscriber will be subscribed from this broker. Here we have a broker. So here you can see this picture. In this picture you have topic. So previously there was a question, what is a broker? So broker is a software here you are having in the middle where the publisher and subscriber are called clients. So even the publisher is called client and subscriber is called client. So the thing is, like, client can be a publisher or a subscriber. He can publish the data as a topic and he can subscribe the data by topic. So publisher, if he is sending any data to the broker, so he is a publisher, he is publishing something, he is publishing a data. So how do we know that he is publishing the data, and the subscriber, the other node on the other side, how does he know that he is getting the same data that he wanted? So that's where the picture of topic comes in. So publisher will give a specific topic name to the data what he is sending. So I will give the topic name, and the subscriber over here on the other end will subscribe to the specific topic name from the broker. So publisher will send the topic to the broker, and the broker will check for the subscribers who subscribe for the topic, and it will send the specific data what the topic, based on the topic, to the subscriber. This is the complete flow of this MQTT. So when coming to the enterprise in the physical world, where we are going to use this MQTT protocol. So as we'll see this use case, a small use case where imagine that there is a, this is how the MQTT has been origin. So there is a requirement in the desert, there is a huge oil pipeline where they need to know, it's a huge desert. So this is a real example. So in this huge desert, there is a huge oil pipeline where we need to check whether the connection, there is no loss in pipes, or there is no hole in the pipe, or the temperature is maintained constantly. Whether, we don't know if the temperature increases, the oil might get heated and there might be a occurrence of a fire. So they need this data. So how the oil is flowing through these pipes, and how, at what time, how much flow is there, or what is the temperature of it. There might be specific requirements of them. So they had this requirement that we need to collect the data at different places of this oil pipe. But neither a person can go personally and check this, what's happening at each and every point. So what they have done, they are in a requirement of collecting data, and they have different nodes. So they have deployed n number of nodes, like 1,000, 2,000. So if we use any traditional protocol to collect the data from this, so it's a very high header, and we can't collect the data from all these. So even that, as I said, the battery constraints is also there, the hardware constraints is also there, and the CPU computation also should be checked. So the thing what they have done is, okay, the MQTT is very light protocol, so they have developed the MQTT protocol for this application, and they have collected the data from different nodes, and they have sent to the satellite. From the satellite, they have sent to the broker. So once the broker gets the information from the nodes, each and every node, what's happening with node 1, node 2, as MQTT will be having different levels, hierarchy levels. So node 1, so oil pipeline, node 1. Imagine this is as node 1 slash node 1. Imagine this one as node 2 slash node 2. So each and every node, we have different hierarchies. Okay, from this node, I got this information. From the second node, I got this information. Everything will be stored in the broker. And once it's stored in the broker, and here you can see the industrial enterprise messaging. So billing, maintenance, SCADA. So here we have different subscribers who are, so here these nodes are publishers over here, which are publishing the data using MQTT. And here we have different subscribers for billing, for maintenance, for SCADA, which are requirement of this data for the maintenance or for the billing of it. So they are getting this data by subscribing to this topic. So MQTT broker or server. So here we have different commercial brokers like IBM, Software AG, DC Square. So open source also are available, like Mosquito, which you can see online, ActiveMQ, Apollo, and Mosquito. These are few, and web hosted brokers are also available. So these are the few examples which we can commercially open source are available and web hosted available. So MQTT specifications we have here. MQTT version 3.1 is the latest specification of MQTT. And here you, which are based on TCP/IP, and here you have MQTT SN, where it is non-TCP/IP based, such as ZigBee and all. So these specifications are for ZigBee. And we have here the commercial enterprise level applications where we have used this MQTT protocol. Here you can see CC, which is been used for the people, deaf people, and here you can see Llama, which by IBM enterprises, which will give available information available to people in the way that is relevant to interest and location. Web Square MQ by IBM, so GainDB. So these are few enterprise level applications which are using MQTT. And the famous thing what we know in our daily use is the Facebook Messenger. So even the Facebook Messenger is using MQTT. So this, as it is very less header, as I said, the battery constraints also very important, so it has very less bandwidth, and so usage of battery is also very less, so they are using the MQTT. So guys, this is about the MQTT. So next my colleague will be taking over the session for to the co-app. So I am passing it over to Dhwani.
All right. So that was the quick introduction about MQTT, and as I can see, many questions are coming up. So definitely, guys, we'll try to we both will try and answer maximum of your questions at the end, as I told you. So now let's understand what is CoAP, in which cases or in which scenarios the CoAP can be used, and how the CoAP is different from MQTT. Like, what can be the scenarios where we can go for MQTT and where we can go for CoAP, right? So now let's understand what is CoAP and where we have to use it and why it is specifically developed. So as you can see now, there is the big era of Web of Things. Earlier only people and mobile phones were using the internet, right? And now, as you can see, I have placed a few devices here or a few things here, like your car, your mobile phone, your gaming devices, and your toaster machine as well. So basically nowadays, everything is connected over the web. Not only humans are required the web, things have also started using the web, right? So this is basically web of things or internet of things is. Now, if you see around you, many devices are very constrained. Like, let's say if you take an example of a tube light or if a tube bulb, it's a very constrained device. It has very low power or what you can say, it is the power constrained device, right? If you consider your mobile battery, it is again a very less power constrained device. So whatever device it is, which will have a deficiency or which you can say, which are constrained in terms of a power, in terms of hardware, in terms of anything. So specifically, CoAP is a protocol which is designed for these kind of constrained devices. The name itself implies CoAP is nothing but the constrained application protocol. Right. So this is the protocol which is specifically designed for that devices which are constrained in terms of power, in terms of hardware, in terms of anything. It could be anything. So moreover, more specifically, I can say it is the poor man's HTTP, because CoAP follows the architectural style of HTTP itself. The RESTful HTTP architectural style is used by the CoAP. So in the same way, it also uses all the method that is your get, put, post and delete method of HTTP as well. So in our training program, we have designed the hands-on session on each and every method that the HTTP is using. So how those methods are used by CoAP, that also have included in the training sessions. So now let's talk more about the CoAP. So basically, as I've told you, it is the constrained application protocol, which is specifically designed for constrained devices. Also for the web transfer protocol, because same nowadays we want to make the connection between the things, right? So that is the reason it is also termed as a web transfer protocol. Again, it is more suited for M2M, for machine to machine kind of wherein you have to make a communication between two machines. So basically it is also known as a M2M protocol. For example, if we talk about some of the examples, so smart energy, the building automations, and many more, even the smart parkings are nowadays using the CoAP as their communication protocol, right? Now let's see the overview. As I've said, it is inspired by HTTP. Again, I'm telling you, it is inspired by HTTP. It is not a replacement of HTTP. It is inspired by HTTP. So in that case, it uses all the four methods, that is get, put, post and delete methods of HTTP. Specifically, it is used for point-to-point communication, for one-to-one communication, wherein, you know, your constrained device is in need to communicate between, is in need to communicate with the server. In that case, you can use the CoAP as your communication protocol. Again, lightweight, very less header size, energy efficient, very less power is used. And moreover, if you compare it with HTTP, it has two additional feature, that is your observe and discovery. Now these two, I can say, very beautiful features of CoAP. Whatever resources are created in your client side, you are able to observe and discover those resources. Now what do you mean by observe and discover? You'll have the practical feel of that also in the training, definitely. Here what I can give you is just an idea, like whatever resources that are available at your server side, you'll be able to observe those resources. Moreover, you can discover those resources. Moreover, you can create those resources. So this is the feature. These are the basic features of CoAP, which sets CoAP apart from HTTP. Along with that, confirmable, or what you can say, the guarantee of delivery of your messages or your request or response. So that part is also taken care by your CoAP. As Bhanu has explained you, in MQTT, we have three kind of quality of services, 0, 1 and 2, which will give you the guaranteed delivery of the messages. In the same way, in CoAP also, we have that kind of functionality. But here we have the confirmable and non-confirmable, two types of quality of services, where confirmable will give you the delivery report in the real life example, if I talk about it. So whatever delivery report you are getting will be the confirmable messages. And when, let's say, you're not, you have off that you have turned off that option of getting delivery report, it will be just fire and forget. You will not care whether the message is delivered at the endpoint or not. So these kind of features and functionality are also taken care by the core app. Now these are some more listed feature here. As you can see, now this is the most what you can say, if I write HTTP over here, it will become very familiar to all of us, right? Because http://, and then URL. This is the most common format we use. So same, as I said, it is inspired by HTTP. The format of writing URIF for OAP is also same. Again, it is asynchronous transaction model. Asynchronous means here the connection will be established at one end. Like let's say whenever the CoAP client is communicating with your CoAP server, that communication will be stable, it will be established. But in case of HTTP, this limitation comes around. And the important thing is CoAP lies on top of UDP, wherein your HTTP, your MQTT, and your other communication protocols lies on top of TCP. So this is the I can say the core difference between those two. Why UDP? Because CoAP has the capability to even work with IPv6. It can either work for IPv4 and it can also work for IPv6. So IPv6 basically supports UDP on downline of it. So that's the reason CoAP basically runs on top of the UDP. Along with that, again, all the four methods are being supported. Simple 4-byte header. It has the feature of discovery. As I said, observer and discovery are the two features we have. Along with that, we have one more feature called block transfer. Like whatever the data, let's say what the huge data is coming as response to the request for client, the CoAP has a feature to divide it into the block, or moreover you can say the fragmentation is one of the feature of it. Whatever data is coming in from server to the client will be divided into the blocks, and then depending on that blocks, the data will be merged at the end side and it will be given as the response to your client. So this feature also, we have the practical feel of that. So moreover, I can say these are some highlighted feature that sets CoAP apart from your HTTP. So this is the basic architecture. Now many times it happens, like let's say your client is using HTTP, but the device is constrained. So in that case, what you have to do, you have to like use the concept of proxy. Now what happens here is whenever the client is using HTTP and the server is CoAP server, proxy server is acting as a middleman which will, you know, make the communication happen between HTTP to CoAP. Now this is again one of the feature which is known as a proxy feature of CoAP. Now this feature is not available in any of the other communication protocol, right? So here proxy is nothing but whatever request is coming in from the client in terms of HTTP will be converted into the CoAP request and it will be served to the CoAP server. And so basically your proxy works as both to and fro kind of the mechanism. To and fro mechanism is possible with the help of CoAP proxy. So this is the idea behind this. So as you can see, CoAP is very efficient, RESTful protocol, specifically used for constrained devices, used for M2M applications, and as I've said you, it is easy to proxy to and from HTTP. Whether the request is coming from the client is in HTTP or let's say HTTP server is there and a CoAP client is there. In that case also your proxy suits well. It is able to make the communication happen between HTTP client and CoAP server, right? And as I've already told you, it is not a replacement of HTTP. It's just you can say the mirror image of HTTP might be, but it's not a replacement of that. HTTP compression, definitely it's HTTP compression. Why? Because we have several more features like discovery, observer, block transfer, proxy. So definitely there is a heavy weightage if you compare little bit. We have the very beautiful comparison slide also wherein you will have the clear understanding of why CoAP, why not HTTP, or why the CoAP is little bit popular depending on that. And restricted to isolate automation networks. That means lossy networks is, or moreover I can say CoAP is more prone to lossy networks. Let's say if the network is very heavy or the network range are very jammed or very traffic network is there. So CoAP is a protocol which suits well in that case. Now these are the advantages. Again, as I've said, the proxy infrastructures are there. A push notification, you will have the delivery of discovery features you have, and multicasting is also possible. Now there is a big difference, guys, between multicasting and broadcasting. So multicasting is, moreover, you can say the feature of that. So in multicasting, what happens? Let's say whenever there would be a group of specific people only where you want to push the message or you want to send the message. Broadcast means one to all and multicast means one to many. So whatever the group of people you are interested in, you can send the messages to those. So these kind of features and functionalities are also available in CoAP, right? Now, if we talk about some limitations, definitely everything comes with some of the limitations, right? So these are some few limitations I can say. In terms of security, if you talk, so definitely it has only the DDoS and TLS layer of security. Again, basic security is there, like HTTP authentication, ID and password. Apart from it, it little bit lags into the into the security kind of area. And a caching request should also be allowed. I mean, caching request is allowed here. Like, let's say when if the connection is being broken out, the server has to request to the client for connection purpose. So these are few limitations that are there. But as I have written here, the work in progress. So definitely once the developers will start developing on CoAP, definitely these limitations will also be triggered out. And these are some implementations. ContiKey is one of the booming OS, and in our training sessions we have the practical depending upon the ContiKey operating system. Along with that, if you can see, implementations are available in many of the languages like .NET, Python, Java. We have proxies, we have CoAP and Californium also. Californium is one of the best CoAP implementation. And in our training sessions also, we're going to use Californium as the core implementation for the CoAP, right? And this is the basic, I can say, the diagram wherein you will have the little bit understanding about HTTP and MQTT. So as you can see, these are the nodes. This is the CoAP node and this is the MQTT node. So MQTT uses TCP on the downline of MQTT, TCP is used. Again, suitable for both V4 and V6, most widely used for V4. But if you compare it with CoAP, it uses UDP. Why? Because it is more prone to IPv6. In the same way, HTTP is used, but it uses TCP/IP as the down layer. And if you talk about CoAP, it uses UDP, right? In the same way, these are some node, these are the CoAP clients, which basically uses UDP to communicate with the cloud. And if you talk about MQTT, it will be the MQTT broker which will be acting as a gateway, and it will use the TCP to communicate with the cloud, and then the cloud will talk about the end devices. Okay, all right, so this is the basic questions. I'll just walk you through a few important points. Like in transport, we CoAP uses TCP, and HTTP and MQTT uses the TCP connection. Again, if you talk about the messaging area, request response, only MQTT is the one which uses request response and publish subscribe both. And rest of the parts are like not that much important. Maybe we can skip those. Again, if you talk about suitability, connectivity, those, all of these are excellent. Again, LLN, as I've said, you lossy networks are in terms of lossy networks area, CoAP suits well, right? So this is just the quite, I can say, the comparison. Now these are the hardware kit which we'll be shipping to your places once you register for the training, and these are the practical flow. So we'll be using NodeMCU, which will be acting as a client, which will be acting as a publisher or subscriber. Along with that, we'll be using lenses which are Chrome plugin. And this is the CoAP flow diagram wherein we will be using Californium implementation like Cooper. Alright, so these are the training provided by Exelta. I think we have talked about it. So thank you guys, and now we'll just take up a few questions about it. Okay, so as I can see, so let me just take questions maybe from the first side. Okay, so MQTT follows which technology? So
Dhwani?
Yeah.
Dhwani, just a second.
Sure.
Hello everyone, this is Amita here. I am the business head, technical training head with Exelta Systems. And first of all, thank you everyone for joining us. I just want to take quick 2 minutes to tell you that since this is a free webinar, I mean it's scheduled only for an hour, we may not be able to cover all your questions or queries. So I will request Dhwani and Bhanu to take maximum questions as far as possible. So it is basically we have 10 minutes before we complete the webinar. So for next 15 to 20 minutes, they will try to answer as many questions as possible, and then we will wind up. Later on, if you have further questions, you can definitely write to us. Also, our complete 3-day MQTT plus CoAP boot camp is coming up, so you can check that. Also, probably next month we are going to launch a full-fledged IoT boot camp on different protocols like MQTT, CoAP, XMPP, AMQP, also the wireless ones like Wi-Fi, the 3GPP and non-3GPP standards. The details will be out soon on our website. So thank you everyone for joining us, and I will request now Dhwani and Bhanu to take up the questions and take 15-20 minutes more and try to answer as many questions as possible. If we are not able to answer some of the questions, please write to us on corporate@exelta.com. Yes, Dhwani, you can continue.
Yes, thank you, Amita. So guys, now there is one question: MQTT follows which technology? So I think one of my colleague Dheeraj has already answered it. So MQTT you can use with Wi-Fi and the GSM technologies as well. Or moreover, as I said, all the technologies that works on TCP can go with MQTT, because as I said, MQTT lies on top of TCP/IP. So I think that is clear now. Can you elaborate RESTful? So Srinivasan, RESTful is a very big term. Now what happens, what basically RESTful is, it is an architectural style. So for every protocol, there is an architectural style. Now let's say we both are talking to each other. So only protocol is not enough for us. We have to use like our frequencies matching, our voice capabilities are matching. So basically your every protocol is merged with the RESTful, with the architectural style. And that architectural style is nothing but your REST. So this is just, I could say the basic idea about RESTful web services. But if you talk about in terms of technology, it's a very huge term to explain, right? And CBOR means, Patina, I didn't get your question. Like, can you, if you can, it would be really great if you can tell me where you have find this term into my slides, that maybe I can get an idea and I can explain you about it. TCP is not in there in the IoT stack. Yes, sir, I got your point. So let me just quickly go back to that slide. Okay. So what you can say IoT and web stack comparison, right? If you compare your IoT stack with your, just a second, with your OSI model, so basically your TCP falls under, this is the TCP/IP, so this is your TCP falls under the transport layer, right? So in the same way, your CoAP and MQTT are falling in the application layer. So whatever, as you can see, so basically what I'm trying to tell you is CoAP and MQTT runs on top of TCP/IP. That means you're they uses TCP to their downline. Right, so UDP is preferable for CoAP and TCP is preferable for MQTT and other protocols. Difference between LOPAN and MQTT, which is better? Okay, so if you talk about LOPAN and MQTT, MQTT is much more better. Or even you can go for LOPAN as well, but what happens is, now see, both are good at their own sites. Why? Because LOPAN is most widely used for constrained devices. But if you talk about MQTT, MQTT is more prone to one-to-many kind of communication range, like wherein you have a publish and subscribe model is followed by MQTT, right? So for MQTT, where you are in need to make a communication happen between one-to-many, you can go for MQTT. Wherein there is point-to-point or constrained device kind of part, you can go with 6 minutes. And moreover, LOPAN is a concept. It's not like a communication protocol. So it depends on what kind of use case or what kind of project you are building. Can we get recording after this webinar? Yes, Rajat, we will be sharing the YouTube link for the webinar. MQTT can be used on Wi-Fi, yes. Okay, so what is the range of MQTT? Will devices be connected to ISP or we can create your own device? So I think Jagadish has already given you the answer, Saurabh. MQTT is not a hardware, it's a protocol. So MQTT doesn't specify a range because it is a protocol, it is application layer protocol. So it doesn't specify any range, it depends on your use case, right? Let's say wherever you want to make a communication from your gateway to your cloud, you can go with MQTT because it termed as the long range communication protocol. Okay, so if I can go down, any security? So yes, Saurabh, both the protocol are more constrained about, or what I can say, the more secured. Because TCP and UDP both itself are the secure protocol, but definitely yes, if you talk about a little bit security constraint about UDP uses only the basic HTTP authentication, but if you go for MQTT, it is highly secure. Concentrator is the gateway. Yes, definitely it would be a gateway because both of these protocols are from communication from your gateway to cloud. Okay, so in the oil pipeline, there is a question from oil pipeline. Can you explain, elaborate all the communication protocols among node, satellite, tower, broker and subscribe node? Okay, so let me just go back to that slide quickly. Okay, so in this example, you want to take, okay, so I think Bhanu is the right person to give the answer of this question.
Saurabh, the question is what communication channel or protocol between nodes and the satellite. In the communication channel, it's a RF frequency where it will be communicating with the nodes. What is the gateway they are using, the hardware constraints and the hardware what they have used, that is not specified here, but the protocol what they use for communicating between the subscriber and the publishing, how they are publishing the data and how they are subscribing the data is the protocol. It's based on MQTT only, but what is the hardware they are using to deliver it, the specific packets to the software, so that is not specified, and the channel mostly it will be RF signals. So there is one more question in the oil pipe example X. Can you please elaborate all the communication protocols among nodes, satellite, tower, broker and subscriber? The same question, between the node-to-node communication, we don't know what nodes they have used and how they are interfacing with each other. They might be RS-232 or any industrial applications where they have different interfaces to communicate between nodes and nodes. Either it might be ZigBee or else further along, if there is a long range, they might be having some other communication channels. So it all depends on the hardware what they are using. So what is used in WhatsApp Messenger? So that we don't know what they are using in WhatsApp Messenger, but FB Messenger, they are using MQTT as it's very light. So as I said before, it's very constrained for the battery usage and all. So as the header size at the minimum packet they have to send, even our messages will be in KBs only. So it requires very less, it has very less data to send. So that's why they are using MQTT in our FB Messenger. That's it. I'll pass it on to Dhwani.
So now the next question is about how the MQTT CoAP HTTP architecture will be implemented. Now Ankush, for all of these three protocols, we have the different implementations. There is no specific implementation for HTTP because it is the protocol which is used nowadays into the web kind of communication. But if you talk about MQTT and CoAP, I've already shown you the implementations of for the both, right? So we have the specifications and we have the specific implementations for MQTT and CoAP, so that you have to use whenever you are in need to use these kind of protocols. Okay, and these PPTs will not be shared. We will be sharing the YouTube video link with you, so that you can refer with the video itself. MQTT is for constrained resources. In specification, it says constrained resources means power cost and small. Can you please stop there? Pratibha, it's your choice. I cannot say that MQTT is not used for constrained devices. It could be used for constrained devices as well, but it depends on your need. Wherever you are in need to make a point-to-point connection, you can go with CoAP. Wherein you are in need to make the communication in terms of broadcasting kind of applications, you can go for MQTT. So both of the protocol are well suited for the constrained devices, but wherein the point-to-point connection has to be maintained, you can go for CoAP. It is a well-suited protocol, I could say. And wherein broadcasting kind of operations you have to maintain, you can go for MQTT. The choice is yours. CoAP and MQTT both are going to communicate to server. Where to use both? So I think I have given the answer, Ankush. Wherever you want to create point-to-point communication, you can go for CoAP. Wherein you are in need to make the communication between one-to-many or many-to-many kind of areas, you can go for MQTT. I mean, CoAP ensure no packet loss if not TCP. Okay, so I think Amita was giving the answers to many of the questions in between. Okay, so in the case sensor, should there be an MQTT or CoAP client node to be installed on them? No, Ranjish. Basically, your MQTT and CoAP client should be involved, or I could say it should be installed on your gateway at the gateway level and not on the node level, because both of these protocols are widely used to make communication between your gateway to cloud. Okay, alright guys, so what we'll do is we'll end up the session. For others who have got the doubt, please write to us. My email ID is dhwani@exelta.com. And my colleague's mail ID is @exelta.com. So these are our mail IDs, guys. Please write to us in case if you have more difficulties or queries. So I hope the session was informative and quite good. All right, guys. So thank you so much.
Thank you guys, we are closing the session and you can enroll for the training. So we have provided the links on you on your chat, so we'll repost it again, so you can join us on the training.
Thank you guys.